Hi everyone, thank you for joining me today to talk about immigration matters and specifically issues for hiring and compliance in the long-term care industry. Today we're going to talk about some of the various options you might want to consider if you want to supplement your staff with an international workforce, and we'll go through some of the options for both short-term and long-term hires. Before we get into the details of our discussion, I would like to go over some brief housekeeping notes with all of you. Throughout the presentation, you are welcome to submit your questions and answers at any time. I will do my best to get to your questions during the presentation, but if not, I will be taking questions at the end of the presentation as well. Please complete the survey that you'll receive at the end of today's webinar. And for CLE credit, which is available in Texas and Tennessee, please be sure to submit your BAR number. You will also receive a PDF of the presentation after the webinar, and feel free to connect with us. The Twitter link for our Baker Donelson website is at the bottom of your screen. So to get started, we all know that the long-term care and the healthcare industries are facing a labor shortage. Healthcare, elderly care, long-term care are some of the fastest growing industries in the United States at the moment simply because of our aging population. Healthcare is projected to grow and add over 2.3 million jobs between 2014 and 2024, as predicted by the Bureau of Labor Statistics. And in terms of immigration sponsorship, a lot of industries, not just healthcare, but a lot of industries have decided to supplement their workforce with foreign national hires as a way to ensure that they have adequate staffing to meet their short-term and long-term obligations. So that's what we're going to talk about today, is what can you do if you don't already have some sort of immigration program in place? What kind of options can you think about to hire workers? In today's presentation, we don't have enough time to really talk about every single option, the pros and cons of each, and how to get an approval, but I can give you some oversight into some options that you may or may not have considered in the past, and which many of your competitors in the same industry might already be implementing. Again, we know that the elder population, 65 and plus, share of the population is rapidly growing. It went from 4.1% in 1900 to 8.1% in 1950, 12.4% in the year 2000, and it's projected to reach 19.6% by the year 2030. A significant portion of that population obviously is going to require elder care and health care support, and there is simply not enough U.S. staff for that. Immigration and the sponsorship of foreign national workers will alleviate that problem. And this is one example here on your screen. For example, 15% of U.S. nurses are foreign education, with the vast majority of those foreign educated nurses being from the Philippines. This is just one example. We can continue to talk about more examples on foreign national hiring as we go through the slides. So there are two categories of sponsorship that I do want to talk about today: immigrants versus non-immigrants. An immigrant worker is somebody who is applying for a temporary non-immigrant status in the United States. That is short-term work authorization. For example, there is an H-1B, TN, E-3, a whole alphabet soup of potential visa categories for people who want to work on a short-term basis in the United States. And what I would like to do is talk to you about some of the most commonly used temporary work authorization categories. You have probably heard of the H-1B, and today we will spend the majority of our time on the H-1B category. It is the most commonly used work visa category in the United States for temporary employment. The biggest thing you have to keep in mind if you want to think about an H-1B for your workforce is that it's reserved for specialty occupations. And in essence, that means the position you are offering has to require at least a bachelor's degree in a specific field of study in order to be eligible for approval. So this is reserved for your professional positions. It does require a demonstration that the employer has a sustained history of hiring only bachelor degrees individuals for a particular position, that it's perhaps common in the industry to absolutely require a bachelor's degree for that position, and that the duties of the job are sufficiently complex enough so as to require that somebody has to have a bachelor's degree in order to perform the duties of that position. There is a prevailing wage requirement. A prevailing wage is, according to Department of Labor wage statistics, the average wage paid to other workers holding a similar type of job in the same or similar area of employment of the position where you wish to have your H-1B worker work. That prevailing wage must be met for the H-1B worker for any time they are employed by your organization. And sometimes that average wage, that prevailing wage, is a little bit of a surprise to employers when they get started on an H-1B. Perhaps employers are not aware of what the prevailing wage rates are, or the salary or hourly rate comes as a little bit of a surprise. So if you haven't been doing a high number of H-1B visas in the past, that would probably be one of the first things to think about, is what kind of positions am I sponsoring, and let me find out what is the appropriate prevailing wage before getting started on the H-1B. If you find out in the process that you simply cannot pay the prevailing wage, then that's something to know sooner rather than later into the H-1B process. The good news about the H-1B visa sponsorship is it does not require you to have any sort of showing that you've tried to recruit for the position and couldn't find anybody for the job. It doesn't require that you need to show a shortage of workers in a particular area or in a particular type of position in order to qualify for an H-1B. For the healthcare industry, the most commonly used types of positions for the H-1B are nurses, physical therapists, and occupational therapists, which we'll talk about each one in detail, and we'll also spend a good amount of time talking about H-1Bs for physicians if you want to hire any foreign physicians at your organization. The other really big thing to keep in mind about H-1Bs is that you sort of have to predict in advance how many H-1B workers you are going to need and start the process for sponsorship quite a bit in advance. There are a limited number of H-1B visas made available every year. The filing date to submit an H-1B is April 1st of a given year, and if the case is selected in a lottery system and approved, then the earliest date of employment in H-1B status is October the 1st. So in essence, you might have to predict at the start of a year, January and February, who you want to file H-1Bs for on April the 1st so that they can begin employment in H-1B status October 1st. So it's not necessarily always a quick and easy process unless somebody has an H-1B already. In that case, joining your organization in their already existing H-1B status is not subject to the numerical limitations. So let's talk through some of the most common occupations for H-1Bs in the healthcare long-term care industry. Nurses, by far, we think of nurses as being an H-1B occupation. Except for standard RN, generally has been found by U.S. Immigration Services to not require a bachelor's degree. And that is because many RNs in the United States have associate's degree or a diploma from an approved accredited nursing program, allowing them to practice as a nurse in the state of their employment. That itself takes away the eligibility for H-1B status for most nurses, unless you are in a certain field and those certain positions have been predetermined by USCIS as to require a bachelor's degree. RN positions in genetics, pediatric nurses, oncology, ER, critical care. Nurses in those particular fields are generally required to have a bachelor's degree. Advanced practice nurses are also generally required to have bachelor's degree and thus are eligible for H-1B status. There are also nurses whose practice and focus of their role is more in an administrative or director or executive type position. A supervisor of other RNs may be required to have a bachelor's degree. And if a strong showing can be made that your organization as a whole always requires your nurses to have a degree at a minimum to be hired, then you do have also a strong showing that you can sponsor an H-1B for a nurse. And again, just like any nurse in the United States or in any state in which they are practicing, must have the appropriate licenses. So one of the things you have to think about is what overseas education has this foreign nurse received? Will it be considered equivalent to a nursing program in the United States? And there's also a requirement that nurses pass an English language proficiency test. So that's something else you want to think about if you're interviewing foreign nationals or individuals outside of the United States, is would they be able to pass an English language proficiency examination? Another category is H-1Bs for physical and occupational therapists. Again, we're talking about individuals who have acquired at least a bachelor's degree in these fields, either inside or outside of the United States. So obviously have to have a degree. If it's a foreign degree, they have to have their foreign degree reviewed by the Foreign Credentialing Commission on Physical Therapy, the FCCPT, to show that their educational credentials abroad are equivalent to a bachelor's degree program here in the United States. They have to obtain, through the FCCPT, a visa screen certificate, which is comprised of the education evaluation, a detailed review of their transcripts and the courses that they've taken for acceptability in the United States. There's an English language examination. And then, of course, the person must be always, like anyone else, must obtain the necessary state licenses that are required to practice. Oftentimes, the challenge of obtaining the appropriate state licenses is that the individual is outside of the United States, and they can't get a license until they're here in the United States. But you can't get the H-1B until you meet all of the eligibility criteria for the job. And if you don't have the license, you might not be eligible for the H-1B. So it's sort of this kind of catch-22, which comes first. And USCIS has generally indicated that with the visa screen, you can file the H-1B petition. And the H-1B petition is usually conditionally approved. And once the person is in the United States in H-1B status, they can apply for a Social Security card and obtain the necessary license and then begin to practice. But they can be admitted into the United States in H-1B status initially and then begin work once they have their license issued to them. Another thing to think about as you are wanting to sponsor physical or occupational therapists, the requirements for both are very similar. A thing to think about is how long will all of this take? If you're working against an April 1st filing deadline, which is the filing date with Immigration Services for an H-1B, how far in advance do you need to start thinking about, well, where do I want to recruit from? How will I conduct interviews with somebody outside of the United States? And allowing sufficient time to obtain a visa screen certificate, gather all of the documents for an H-1B filing, and then be ready to submit everything on April the 1st. Allow yourself months to go through that process, especially if you are relatively new to H-1B sponsorship. We advise starting the process in terms of identifying candidates you are wanting to move forward with by January of any year, meaning by that point you've conducted your interviews, you've found somebody you want to try and sponsor, and then you start working with them or with your outside counsel to prepare an H-1B petition. Another thing to keep in mind about any H-1B in these categories, or generally any H-1B for a professional position that you want in your firm or organization is the current immigration environment, which is, as you've probably heard and seen on the news, undergoing a lot of changes. And we are operating in a very stringent and heightened enforcement type of environment. And with that comes heightened scrutiny of particularly H-1B petitions, which in the past has been a category for employment in the U.S. that has undergone some level of fraud and abuse. And so now what that has resulted in is a lot of focus on H-1B compliance, ensuring that the terms and conditions of employment as stated on an H-1B are true and accurate. And what's happened because of that? USCIS has started issuing a very high volume of what's called requests for evidence, RFEs. Now these RFEs are generally any employer, any industry, any type of position. The chances are about 60% or higher there's going to be a request for evidence. But for the healthcare, long-term care industry in particular, there are a few things that tend to be routinely seen in these requests for evidence from the government. It has to do with you sponsored somebody in H-1B status. The H-1B initially can be valid for up to 3 years. The service, the immigration services, wants strong evidence that there is enough work to keep this person busy for the full 3 year time period. And sometimes that can be difficult if you know there's a project or you know there is a certain duration of work for the next 6 months or year, but who knows what will happen 2 or 3 years from now. You're struggling to provide an itinerary of services for a full 3 year time period. Another thing to think about is if your organization frequently outsources your employees, if you're a consulting company, or you're a healthcare provider and source your employees to retirement homes or nursing homes or hospices and hospitals, you are the employer placing your employee at a client site. That in itself is generally a category that is very highly scrutinized by immigration services, and they usually want substantial evidence to show that you, the sponsor of the H-1B, are truly the employer and have a valid employer-employee relationship with the foreign national you want to hire. Who's administering payroll? Who is the employee going to report to? Who controls the duration of the assignment? Who controls the daily work of this H-1B employee? And document that you, the sponsor, are the employer, not your client where the H-1B employee is being placed. All of these things can be overcome with immigration services and get you an H-1B approval. But before you get started, it's helpful for you to know these things so that it's clear that it's not always a clear, easy path to sponsorship. In today's world, things with immigration are becoming more difficult and are becoming much more heavily scrutinized than they have been in years past. So with any of the things we talk about today, it's important to keep in mind the increased timeline it's going to take to get somebody on board and the hurdles you might have to overcome with governmental processing. All right, so let's change gears and talk about the H-1B for physicians. We see a lot of H-1Bs for physicians at clinics, hospitals, multitude of various organizations who want to sponsor H-1Bs for international medical graduates, IMGs. And physicians, of course, usually have to pass and obtain what's known as the ECFMG certificate, which shows that their foreign medical school that they attended abroad, that medical education was equivalent to a U.S. medical school education. And of course, they have to pass the U.S. medical licensing exam, the USMLE Part 1 and Part 2. And just like the nurses and the therapists, they must also pass an English language examination. A lot of the H-1B physicians that we see in the United States have completed medical school abroad, but then came into the United States for residency or their fellowship or both. And then in their training had one status, And then once they have completed their training and want to pursue full-time employment, move into H-1B status for that full-time employment. Some of the things to keep in mind with the H-1B, again, is those requests for evidence. And some of the things we're seeing specifically for physicians in recent months is what's called the level one wage. So we had talked about prevailing wages, which is the minimum wage required to be paid. But when you pull a prevailing wage from the government's source, there are four different levels to the wage, level one being entry level, and level four being the most advanced positions, positions with higher hiring requirements, more education, more experience. So let's say you're trying to find a very entry-level physician, a level one, or any occupation, really. Sometimes USCIS, U.S. Immigration Services, will push back and say, well, it's a level one wage. We don't believe that, in general, a position that is a level one wage is sufficiently advanced enough to qualify for an H-1B. And so it's kind of this battle that employers have to work through in terms of showing that this, the job itself is sufficiently complex and advanced that it requires at least a bachelor's degree, but not so advanced that it pushes it up to a level two, level three, level four wage, which then has much higher prevailing wage requirements. It's actually a conundrum for any H-1B kind of entry-level position that you would think about is that USCIS says it's a level one entry-level position. You don't have to have a degree for that. And the employer saying, well, it's complex enough to require a degree, but not so complex as to go into level two. It comes down to a matter of semantics sometime and just really making sure that the way you describe your positions are accurate and provide enough details that USCIS Immigration has a very clear understanding of what your job entails and what your job requires. Now, an entirely different visa category is called the TN. The TN is a great way if you are looking to sponsor Canadians or Mexican nationals for employment in the United States. So TN comes from NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement, which was designed to facilitate the movement of business and personnel between Mexico, the U.S., and Canada. Now, NAFTA has permitted very limited occupations to be able to enter the United States with a valid offer of employment and to begin working in TN status. If you are Canadian, you are able to take a TN application and submit it at a land crossing border or at a Canadian port of entry. There's also Canadian pre-flight inspections. So if you have somebody flying out of Vancouver or Toronto, Calgary, they go through immigration inspection at the airport in Canada. And so they can present a TN application at the airport or at the land crossing border and undergo a TN application review and then enter the United States with TN work authorization. A Mexican national, on the other hand, is required by law to submit a TN visa application at a U.S. embassy in Mexico or a U.S. embassy outside of the United States. There are limited occupations for the TN status. So as you can see on this list, not every occupation is going to qualify for a TN. But if you think, okay, we need a lot of registered nurses, we really need to ramp up our hiring, and perhaps you have had trouble recruiting from other countries, but you think you could maybe interview in Mexico or interview in Canada, or you have a subsidiary or affiliate in one of those countries, or a branch satellite office that you can place or work with a recruiting agency in Canada, perhaps. This has been a great way to supplement staff. And the great thing about the TN and the remainder of the categories is that there is not a prescribed limit like there is on the H-1B. You're not capped at a certain maximum number of entries into the United States. So if next week you wanted to hire a psychologist from Mexico, it's just a matter of the amount of time it takes to gather all of the supporting documents and prepare a visa application and for them to lodge a visa application, weeks rather than possibly months to find a qualified worker for TN status. Another temporary visa category is called the E3 visa. Now, the E3 visa is going to be almost identical to the requirements of an H-1B, except the E3 is limited to nationals of Australia. So again, if you can show you meet a prevailing wage, that the person has a degree that's equivalent to a U.S. degree, that a degree is required for the position, then the E3 visa is great. Just like the H-1B, there's no recruitment process, there's no requirement of a labor shortage, and generally speaking, the E3 for Australians does not undergo the level of scrutiny that the H-1B does, even though the legal requirements are so very similar. So sometimes the E3 has been a really great option for those companies with some sort of connection to Australia and willingness to hire Australian nationals. The O-1. This one is kind of a really unique category. There is no limit whatsoever in the type of position you can consider for an O-1, but it's a really unique category in and of itself. It's reserved for individuals of extraordinary ability or those whose work and achievements in their field have been considered outstanding. So there has to be some sort of documentary proof that the person's work has been recognized either on a national or international level, and that they have received sustained acclaim for their work, and that their employment in the U.S. is going to be in the same field for which they have been recognized. So obviously the first thing I think that comes to mind is movie star, actor, actress, the Oscar winner, Golden Globe winner, who's everybody knows who they are, and obviously they're extraordinary. The kind of occupations or the kind of positions we don't think about are somebody who's doing really unique cancer research, perhaps, and their work has been published, is well known in the scientific community. Some of their research maybe is being implemented in other countries. They have made presentations about their work. They attend conferences. They engage in peer review, or they're editors of very prestigious journals. That is also considered extraordinary. Or a physician who is very well known in their country, who has received very strong reference letters from other physicians in other countries, letting them the reader know of the wonderful work this physician has done, that can also qualify as extraordinary or outstanding. So there are a lot of different ways that with a little bit of creativity and thought, a person may qualify for an O-1. It's not going to work for the majority of individuals. It's really designed to work for those who have risen to the top of their field. So if you think about individuals you are hiring, think about, does this person have evidence to show that whatever field that they are in and have been working, that they've really risen to the top, and that they have accompanying evidence to somehow demonstrate that well-known recognition for the work that they have been doing in whatever field it is they are pursuing. Another popular category is the J-1 visa. Now, the J-1 is really going to work best for individuals who are undergoing some sort of a short-term training program, or for those individuals who've completed medical school and now want to undergo residency or fellowship in the United States. In essence, the J-1 program was created here in the United States to really serve as some sort of some cultural exchange between the person who's arriving into the U.S. and the work that they would be doing here. And the intent was for them to impart their culture in the United States and then go to their home country to take back their U.S. acquired knowledge to their home country. I mean, J-1s can be au pairs. They can be interns. There are J-1s for short-term and long-term research, and J-1s, of course, for physicians that are in residency and fellowships. The thing to keep in mind about the J-1 is that many individuals, depending on the kind of work they are doing and or their nationality, may be subject to what's called a two-year home residence requirement. That means that at the conclusion of their stay in the United States in J-1 status, they are obligated to return to their home country for a period of no less than 2 years and only return back to the United States once they have completed that two-year home residence requirement. So that's the biggest downside to the J-1. And the J-1 home residency requirement is triggered, again, by nationality and then a very a Department of State designated list of skills that have been determined to have to be a shortage in that country. So India might have a shortage of specific skills. So if that person from India is coming to the U.S. in J-1 status and acquiring knowledge of those skills, then the home residency requirement triggers in because their home country, India, needs somebody with those skills to come back and work there for 2 years at minimum. All physicians who are in the United States in J-1 status, regardless of where they're from, all physicians are subject to a two-year home residence requirement. But the interesting thing about the J-1 for physicians is that that home residency requirement may be waived if the person agrees to work in a medically underserved area for at least 3 years, or that there is a showing that their work is in the public interest and that public interest work takes place for a period of 3 years. So there are ways for physicians to get that waiver. There are also waivers if you can show extreme hardship, if it is dangerous to return to the home country. So waivers are possible, and certainly for physicians, waivers are possible if they are agreeable to working in a medically underserved area. But that's something to think about and certainly discuss with the J-1 candidate before they arrive in the United States to let them know that unless the J-1 two-year home residence requirement is waived, they are obligated to go back to their home country for a period of no less than 2 years. And now, switching gears a little bit, I wanted to talk about the permanent residence or green card process. So we started off the discussion with what is an immigrant versus a non-immigrant. And so far, we've talked about all of the non-immigrant categories or the temporary work visa categories. Now let's talk about immigrant visa processing, or what's commonly known as green card processing, getting to live in the United States on a permanent basis. So generally speaking, the majority of individuals in the United States who have employment-based sponsorship will go through a three-step process towards a green card. That process is initially started with a labor certification, which I tell all of my clients up front that the labor certification is the most intense, the most time-consuming, and mostly the most cost prohibitive part of the green card process. It is challenging because what it involves is a test of the labor market by the employer to see if there are any qualified, willing, and available U.S. workers for the job you are sponsoring this foreign employee. So based on certain government required recruitment and advertising efforts, an employer must review the resumes of anybody who applies for the job to see if, one, are they U.S. workers? Are they U.S. citizens or green card holders? And do they meet every single requirement of the job that I want to move forward with the labor certification with? And if a company or if any employer finds a qualified, willing, and available U.S. worker, you must stop the labor certification process, and you cannot proceed with the permanent residence process for that foreign employee. The point of this requirement is that if there is a U.S. worker who can do the job and you have an open position, the preference is to supply that job and offer that job to a U.S. worker rather than move forward with the sponsorship process of a foreign employee. It is designed to protect the U.S. worker. We work very closely, of course, with our clients to make sure that that advertising and recruiting effort is accurate, it's correct. And we have found that, especially in industries where there is a labor shortage, there is very little difficulty in passing the labor certification process and getting to the end of that labor certification advertising process and not finding a qualified, willing, and available U.S. worker. So once you get the labor certification approved, you move on to step two, which is called an I-140 petition. An I-140 petition is generally the employer showing that the position is still available to the foreign employee, that the foreign employee meets all of the requirements of the position in terms of both education and experience, and that as the employer, you have the ability to pay the person's wage, that you have sufficient net income or net assets or financial reserves to pay this person's wage on an annual basis. And then finally, there is adjustment of status if you're in the United States or consular processing if you're not. And that is the final process, the employee or foreign nationals process to get the green card and authorization to live here permanently. The spouse and or children under the age of 21 of any employee are permitted to join in on these applications. And if you file for adjustment of status while in the United States, the person may also separately apply for a work permit and a travel document, which is very helpful. For example, you have a physical therapist who is working for you in H-1B status. You decide to move forward with the green card process and get through the labor cert, get through the I-140. The physical therapist is here in the U.S. with their spouse and three children, and now you want to file their, they want to file their adjustment of status. Now that spouse, who was in a dependent status and not authorized to work necessarily, can benefit from the pending green card application and that separate application for a work permit. So at this stage, a lot of the family members and some of the older children, too, find a sense of relief that there is interim work authorization now available to them until they get their green card or permanent residence in the United States. Not every type of green card process or permanent residence process is going to require a labor certification. So not to complicate things, but if you look at this chart, there are three different categories of green cards. EB1, EB2, EB3. And in a few minutes, we'll talk about why that becomes important. But generally speaking, when you are thinking about a person's employment and you have their position and you know their occupation and you want to start with the green card process, you've got to think about what category do they fall into. So EB1 is very similar to an O1. It's extraordinary ability or it's outstanding research. These are the people at the top of their field. Excellent research, well-known, they have an international or very strong national reputation, and they have a sustained showing of receiving acclaim for their work. That's EB1. No labor certification is required. You move on right to step two of the green card process, the I-140. Another exception is the EB2 national interest waiver or the physician waiver. So a national interest waiver, and we'll talk about that in a little bit more about how to qualify, does not require a labor certification, usually for where the industry has already determined there to be a shortage of occupation. And then EB2 advanced degree, those are your professional employees with a master's degree or higher. They do require a labor certification. And then there's EB3. Generally, EB3 will always require a labor certification, and these are your either professional workers who have a degree, and then everybody else, skilled workers like your nurses, your occupational therapists, your PTs, or even skilled workers. If you have positions that you do not require a degree, home-based healthcare, home aides, for example, are really common in that degrees are not required, or even the RNs where you haven't been able to show a bachelor's degree is required for the job, they would fall into the skilled worker category. In terms of exceptions to the labor certification process, I had mentioned that the government has already predetermined that certain occupations absolutely have a labor shortage and therefore do not have to go through that labor certification, the point of which the labor certification is to see if you can find a qualified, willing, and available U.S. worker. And certain occupations, we know they're just a complete shortage of workers. That's your professional nurses and your physical therapist. They absolutely do not have to go through the test of that labor market. There is no advertising or recruitment effort. You do have to obtain what's called a prevailing wage, though. And very similar to the H-1B, a labor certification requires authorization or confirmation from the employer that they are going to pay that minimum wage to the worker upon attainment of permanent residence status in the U.S. or their green card. So in all of this too, you have to keep in mind that there are wage requirements for the worker once they get their green card. Some of those, again, wage requirements can be a little bit sometimes what the employer considers to be unreasonable or not necessarily reflective of what is appropriate for their organization. So again, those are some of the things to think about before getting started is, are we in an occupation that we've already demonstrated a labor shortage? If not, what is recruitment and advertising going to look like and cost? What are the chances of finding a qualified worker? And then for any person, are we going to be able to pay the prevailing wage once that person is working and has their green card? We talked about also an exemption to the labor certification being the national interest waiver. And specifically, I wanted to talk about the national interest waiver process for physicians. So physicians in the United States bypass the labor certification process if they agree to a few things. One, work in a clinical practice for a total of 5 years in a primary care as a primary care physician or a specialty physician, and that their employment is in a area that has been determined to have a shortage of physicians. And I've listed some of those on the slide for your review. And the national interest waiver petition has to be accompanied by a federal agency or a state department confirming that the work that the physician is doing is in the public interest, that it is vital to wherever the employment is going to take that the physician be allowed to work, that there is some sort of overall public benefit to this physician's employment in the area of intended employment. So we've talked a lot about the green cards, the type of green cards, the different categories of green cards. But let's talk a little bit about why are those green card categories important. And the reason why that's important is that the U.S. government has made a limited number of green cards available every single year. And that number is further limited by a person's country of birth. So as you can see from this chart, there are all sorts of dates in all different countries, but it'll start with all chargeability areas except those listed. So that's everybody. And then China, El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, India, Mexico, the Philippines, and Vietnam. China all the way down to Vietnam are backlogged, usually pretty consistently because of the high number of people of those nationalities born in those countries who are applying for visas. The government has limited the number of nationalities that can enter the United States per year. And we know a lot of people from the Philippines, Mexico, India, China historically have applied for visas, creating a substantial backlog. And right now there's a backlog regardless of where you're from. Even the all other category is backlogged. And what do I mean by backlog is once you determine who you are sponsoring, the requirements of the position, and the process you are going to pursue, you look back at that chart and say, is this process going to be EB1, EB2, or EB3? That is the employment-based category on the left side. Then you think about where is this person born? Okay, for example, you are doing the green card process for a national of Mexico in the EB3 category because they're a registered nurse. You don't require a degree, so they're an EB3 skilled worker. Right now, for Mexico EB3, it says July 1st, 2016. That means if the person had a labor certification application filed on their behalf July 1st, 2016 or earlier, they are just now, August of 2019, eligible to file the last step of their green card process, which is their personal green card application. You can tell from this chart that backlogs are significant across the board for everybody. It could take years, potentially, for somebody to be able to file for a green card. The one caveat I want to very clearly mention is that it is August. The government's fiscal year starts over October 1st every year. So October 1st, the brand new allotment of visas for that year are instantly made available, and these numbers usually move forward quite a bit. So the wait time will look much less on October 1st than they do here towards the end of the government's fiscal year when all of the visas for the year have been likely used up. But with that being said, most countries listed on here specifically will always have a backlog, and EB3 and maybe even EB2 for all other areas may have a backlog. So anticipate that as you're starting the green card process for some individuals, that it's not a matter of just going through the three steps. It's also, what is the potential delay before the employee can ever file step three of the green card process? And that concludes our presentation for today. I did leave some time for questions and answers, and I did receive some questions, and I did want to remind everybody that if you have questions, to please feel free to use the chat box. You're welcome to type in your question, and I will do my best to answer your question. So the first question is, we're working with a placement company to put international RNs in nursing facilities. It looks like H-1B visas are not typically awarded in this area. Are we seeing an increase in RNs being allowed to work in the United States? Not necessarily. As we talked about in the beginning, the RN category is difficult for, not impossible, but difficult for the H-1B because generally USCIS has held that an RN does not absolutely have to have a bachelor's degree at a minimum for entry into the occupation. But certain specialties for nurses are determined to require a bachelor's degree. If it's a supervisory management type of administrative RN position, it is allowed. Or if you can show a strong showing by your organization that you have a sustained history of hiring nurses with only a bachelor's degree and can clearly articulate why if it comes up with the government, then yes, we have seen organizations who are able to succeed with H-1Bs for nurses. It's not easy, but it's not impossible either. So I think that's something to consider. Nursing is generally a tricky category, but there are ways to be successful with it, especially if you can demonstrate that your organization absolutely requires a degree and you can explain why a degreed professional is required to perform the duties that you are requiring them to carry out in the United States. Some of the other questions that I normally get are about site visits. One of the questions I've received commonly is, we're sponsoring a high number of H-1B workers, and we are starting to get emails from the government about our employees. What do we do? And kind of we talked about this being a very heightened enforcement period for the government, and that comes with a compliance focus too. It comes with the possibility of on-site visits from immigration officers. It comes with the possibility of an immigration officer or supervisor emailing the contact person listed on the immigration forms to verify the employment of the individual. We work often with our clients to prep them in advance for on-site visits, what to do if immigration shows up at the door, who speaks to them, what questions do you answer. But the most important thing is, before getting too far in the immigration process for any individual, as an organization, are you comfortable with the additional scrutiny that might come into your practices? Or are you comfortable if immigration shows up unannounced that somebody will be available to speak with them to address their concerns? And are you certain that you have filed the petition for that worker with the appropriate information about job title, job location, pay? And can you back that up? If an immigration officer shows up and you said this person will be working at a particular location, are they physically really there when the officer shows up? Do you have pay slips to show that they're being paid the wage you said you would pay them? So there are a lot of considerations to think about when it comes to that compliance focus. And I think that wraps up the questions for today. Thank you so much to everybody for joining me. Again, you will have an opportunity to complete a survey at the end of the webinar. Please take an opportunity to do so. I'd love to get your feedback. And if you have any specific questions or any type of question, you are welcome to email me or give me a call, and I'm happy to speak with you. Thanks, everyone, and I hope you have a great afternoon.